Someone may have looked at it, but he did have someone look at it to kind of verify what it was.
Okay.
So, but he, you know, man was much larger before the flood. These people lived right after the flood, the people at the Tower of Babel. And so they would have been extremely large, like the people before the flood.
Yes.
And so we could expect, they have found large skeletons out there near the Noah's Ark area, eastern Turkey, where the first people after the flood were very large. So.
Yes, we are aware of the big size of those people.
Yes.
Who lived there before the flood.
Okay. Good.
Familiar with us, we are not supposed to record now these few seconds before the official interview. We just want to like to thank you very much for your time, your effort for doing this interview, and hopefully we can reach many people around the world and give them the message we need to give them, because we are living in the last times and many people need to know about strong discoveries in order to understand what to do and what is going to happen probably in a few time, in a few years. So that's the main point of the interview, is to spread the message to many people as we can. Okay?
Okay. Thank you.
We need to say a prayer before we start.
I'm going to be...
Can we say a prayer first before we start? Michelle, would you like to? Or Dennis? Dennis, you say prayer. Start.
Yes.
Okay, we're going to say a prayer first.
A prayer, okay. You can go ahead, please.
All right. Notice. Heavenly Father, we thank you for being with us through all times from the very beginning and until to now. And now as we do this interview, we ask for the Holy Spirit to be amongst us, that whatever we say will go forward and to reach others and to bring them into Jesus for eternity and for eternal life. And so we ask direction for whatever we may say, and we ask for direction for the movement of your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 Amen. Thank
you. Amen.
So let me introduce myself. My name is Joaquin. You can call me Jay if you want. I'm going to be the translator. And my side is Victor. He's the main speaker in the conference we give around the world. And the problem is that he doesn't speak English. Okay? So I'll be translating to him what you say.
Okay.
Okay?
Victor, sí que por mí es una gran satisfacción poder hacer esta entrevista con él.
He feels really well and happy to be able to do this interview with you. And he has been waiting a long time to meet this opportunity.
Thank you.
Amen.
Just a little bit of his life. He's been in the Adventist church since like he was 5 years old.
Wow.
And he's been there since then. He's
wow.
Been reading Bible, Helen White, and everything he can to spread the message in a society here in Spain that most of the people, unfortunately, don't believe in God. So he's doing a heavy work trying to give the message, you know.
That's great.
Victor, Kim, sí. Crec que lo millor seria que en Victor fes les preguntes primer en castellà.
Sí.
Ben alt i ben com si fes amb ells i després en quin traduís, perquè si tu dius baixet en català se sent igual, llavors no,
val.
La gent que ho vulgui veure val. Es quedarà igual, val?
Val. Digue'ls que primer farem una introducció per la gent de les conferències del Gran Engany
en castellà, Víctor,
després
en castellà.
Ja comencem, no?
En castellà, Víctor, en castellà millor.
Val. No, és que ara li deia una cosa privada amb en Quim.
Vale, d'acord. Okay, so what we are going to do is Victor here is going to speak in Spanish, like if he was talking to the audience, then I will translate into English the question, and then you can answer. That's how we like to follow this interview. If you're okay. Fine with that?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. And first of all, we'd like to do a little introduction and then go to the questions. So I think from now on, we can start recording what the interview is going to be.
Okay.
When start right now.
En nuestra ya dilatada serie de conferencias tituladas El Gran Engaño, hemos venido presentando en varias ocasiones los descubrimientos del arqueólogo Ron Wyatt, tales como el Arca de Noé en el monte Ararat, en Turquía, la ciudad de Sodoma, destruida por Dios con azufre, el resto de los carros de Faraón bajo el Mar Rojo, la roca de la que brotó agua conocida como la Peña de Oreb, el lugar del monte Sinaí, donde Dios le dio los 10 mandamientos a Moisés, y finalmente, el objeto sagrado más buscado de la arqueología mundial, sin duda, que es el Arca de la Alianza.
In our Spanish-speaking conference called The Great Lie, we have presented many of the discoveries by Mr. Ron Wyatt, such as Noah's Ark, the city of Sodoma, the chariots of the Pharaoh under the Red Sea, the location in Mount Sinai where God gave to Moses the Ten Commandments, and finally, the most important and holy object of the worldwide archaeology, the Ark of the Covenant.
Hoy tenemos el privilegio de poder realizar una entrevista a unas cuantas personas que participaron de estos descubrimientos junto al señor Wyatt, directa o indirectamente.
Today it's our pleasure to interview some of the closest people to Ron Wyatt, who share with him and help him to spread his discoveries around the world.
Ante todo, quisiera agradecerles a todos ustedes por su buena disposición para concedernos esta entrevista para la serie de conferencias El Gran Engaño. Me consta de que han debido hacer diversos ajustes en sus agendas para poder realizar esta entrevista y durante el transcurso de la misma quisiera que quien quiera responder de ustedes libremente lo haga. Y si en algún momento quieren añadir algo totalmente por su parte, también, sin ningún problema.
Okay, so first of all, we'd like to thank every one of you for your time. We know some of you have traveled many miles to be here today. We appreciate that. And during this interview, you are free to speak and answer questions. We'd like to hear different point of views, and we'd like to hear all you speaking and answering these questions.
Okay.
Para empezar, me gustaría que se autopresentaran cada uno de ustedes diciendo su nombre y apellido y su relación o parentesco con Ron Wyatt.
So first of all, I'd like you to introduce yourself, your names and last names, and your relationship with Mr. Ron Wyatt.
De izquierda a derecha.
From left to right, if you like.
Okay. I'm Dennis Shellis. I am the husband of Michelle Wyatt, so I'd be his son-in-law.
This is Michelle Wyatt, Ron's daughter.
I'm Ronnie Wyatt, his youngest son.
I'm Jesslyn Johnson, a friend of Ron's. I worked with him at the hospital, and we visited each other's homes and did some traveling together.
I'm Kevin Fisher with the website arcdiscovery.com, and I met Ron Wyatt back in 1984, and I've been captivated with this information ever since.
Okay, thank you very much. Let's continue. Oh, okay, just wait a second, I'll try to translate what you said. De izquierda a derecha podemos encontrar al marido de Michelle. A su derecha, Michelle, que es la hija de Ron Wyatt. Más hacia la derecha está el hijo de Ron, que es Ronnie. Una amiga de Ron, en su derecha, que se llama Jasmine. Y a la derecha de todo se encuentra Kevin Fisher, que forma parte del equipo del museo y amigo de Ron desde hace muchos años, quien fue en sus expediciones también.
Para empezar, me gustaría también que nos hablaran de la persona de Ron Wyatt. ¿Cuál era su carácter? ¿Cómo era como padre? como esposo, como compañero de trabajo y como creyente.
Okay, next question is about how you saw Ron Wyatt as a human being, his character, how was he as a father, as husband, as a co-worker, or as a believer? What's your opinion on him?
I wanted to thank you, first of all, for spending your time giving this message to the people in Spain. I know that God will bless your efforts. Dad, he raised us in the church to believe in the Bible, and the reason that he pursued these discoveries because he wanted other people to also believe the truth in the Bible and be saved when Jesus comes.
Okay, let me translate that, please. Michelle nos da las gracias por nuestro tiempo haciendo esta entrevista y básicamente nos cuenta que Ron era un gran creyente desde pequeño. Su inspiración viene de la Biblia, de la palabra de Dios, y esto es lo que siempre ha querido, transmitir esta palabra a todas las personas para que puedan entender lo que sucede y qué es lo que se dice en la Biblia. Okay. Is somebody else wants to?
My father was really devoted to God and to the archaeology. He hated the fact that people misrepresented the truth about the Red Sea crossing site and all the scientific explanations for some of the miracles that God did. And so he wanted to go and prove that the Bible was true, exactly word for word. And it was a pleasure and honor helping him.
Bien, nos está contando aquí que Ron era un gran creyente, un creyente en la Biblia, en la palabra de Dios escrita en la Biblia, y él, su intención era demostrar científicamente que lo que se explica en la Biblia es lo que realmente ocurrió en el pasado, y él lo que quería es explicar tales hallazgos a través de la arqueología. Y toda la gente que no entendía o le criticaban por este tipo de cosas, entonces esto no le gustaba demasiado, porque él a lo contrario estaba intentando demostrar que lo que se dice en la Biblia es lo que pasó, y él lo demostró con estas pruebas arqueológicas. Okay. Yeah, go ahead, Justin.
I met Ron in the late 1960s at church, and then later at the hospital where we worked. We worked several years together, and we went to some classes together, and we visited in each other's homes, and I was on a tour in Israel in 1994 with him, and visited with him when he was in the hospital. And he was a person who had goals that that he just was so deeply into that nothing could discourage him. He worked really hard. I found him to be an honest person, and he loved the Lord and read his Bible and Ellen White's writings. Ellen White was his favorite author other than the Bible, and I used to hear him talk about what he wanted to do, what he wanted to find, and why, and he just was a most interesting person.
Jaslyn nos cuenta sobre que hace tiempo se conocieron con Ron White desde los años 70. Ellos trabajaron juntos en un hospital. Se conocieron bastante, pudieron hablar de muchas cosas sobre la Biblia, y ella vio que Ron siempre fue una persona honesta, creyente, y siempre había seguido lo que estaba intentando descubrir y mostrar a la gente.
Kevin? Yes, so Ron was a very humble man who wanted to help his fellow man. Before he ever found anything, he said, he prayed to the Lord, Lord, help me find something that will help someone get to heaven. He had a burden for souls, and that's the way his life really was. He was a humble servant of the Lord, and yet the devil has tried to attack him with lies. But from what I saw, he was a very, very humble man who loved the Lord, and it's been a blessing to have known him.
Kevin nos dice que Ron era una gran persona, todo lo que él hacía no lo hacía por sí mismo, sino para servir a Dios y llegar a la gente para poder dar el mensaje y salvar almas para Dios, que es lo que él trabajaba. Entonces las personas que hablaban mal de él o habían mentido sobre él es algo que no se entendía, ya que simplemente él hacía, intentaba hacer lo que Dios le mandaba para salvar a las almas, básicamente. No, para él mismo no lo hacía.
Hay algo que a mí personalmente me preocupa especialmente, y fue su encuentro con los dirigentes adventistas, que parece ser que lo desacreditaron. ¿Cómo fue? Parece que en el primer momento todo iba bien, pero después las cosas cambiaron y tomaron un rumbo muy contrario. ¿Por qué? ¿A qué se debió? ¿Quiénes se posicionaron en contra y qué argumentaron para tomar esta actitud? ¿Cuál es la posición actual de la denominación adventista actualmente en cuanto a esto?
Okay, oh, there is something that really worries me when the Adventist leaders discredit Ron. What happened? It seems that in the beginning everything was going fine, but things changed later and took an opposite direction. Why? What happened? Who were they and what were the arguments? What is their point of view today?
Do you understand the question?
How do you know? Well, they may have originally supported him, I don't know, but I do know today the conference, the church, the Seventh-day Adventist Church is in apostasy. So we cannot expect them to be freely embracing the discoveries or freely embracing Ron, because it goes against the grain. Satan does not want this material shown to the world. It's not popular to support the discoveries. It's not popular to support the truth, period, especially when we're talking about eternal truth, biblical truth. So this same conference will meet with the Pope. The same conference is in apostasy. They want favor of the world, and we cannot look to them as to whether or not they're going to accept Ron Wyatt and the discoveries. They're not in the will of God. Mrs. White said they were no longer the voice of God in session. So it doesn't matter to me if the conference is not supporting Ron Wyatt and doesn't agree with his findings, because to me they're out of the will of God. They're not following the spirit of prophecy properly. They've started a new organization compared to that which Ellen White supported. So anyway, that's just the straight truth, from my opinion.
Bien, aquí nos... Oh, yes, Jasmine?
May I say that I believe...
Un momento, primero la traducción, porque si no es mucho trozo.
Let me translate before, Jasmine.
Gracias.
Lo que Kevin nos dice básicamente es que a él personalmente no le importa si la gente apoya a Ron o no. La visión de Ron sobre los descubrimientos no es algo, podríamos decir, mundano, como buscan muchos podríamos decir, asociaciones o conferencias diferentes, sino que es algo muy espiritual y a veces no puede llegar la gente a estas conclusiones porque quizá no tienen la fe suficiente para llegar a tal conclusión. Entonces es algo que básicamente a Kevin no le importa, pero es así, es fue tal como ocurrió. Mucha gente no dio soporte a Ron en sus descubrimientos.
Sí, ¿y actualmente cómo sigue?
Can you say why today people is not still supporting Ron's discoveries after all the everything he showed and the videotapes and all we have?
You're asking why the conference does not support?
Yes, after all he did with showing us all these great discoveries and everything, why still today they don't support him?
Because it's not popular to support the discoveries. Most archaeologists don't believe in the discoveries. Our archaeologists at the Horn Archaeological Museum at Andrews here in the U.S., they don't believe in the discoveries because it's not popular. They're interested in winning a popularity contest, the conference. And so they would be viewed by the archaeological community as extremist radicals if they believed in the discoveries, because Satan has everyone believing, the major archaeologists, that the discoveries are man-made, that Ron was a fraud. And so it's the conference doesn't want to stand up for the truth, basically.
Bien, aquí Kevin nos dice que las conferencias o la gente detrás de los que no apoyan los descubrimientos de Ron es básicamente porque no ven estos descubrimientos como algo creíble para el público, algo que pueda ser popular, y entonces se decantan por otro tipo de descubrimientos arqueológicos. Okay, Jasmine?
I would like to say that the conference, though it does not support Ron Wyatt, does believe that the finds are real. Ron told me that he went to the conference and was asking their opinion as to how he could best present these finds to the people, the Seventh-day Adventist people, so that they would study the Bibles, realize everything is true, and get ready for Jesus to come. And the conference suggested that they have a meeting of some men and have Ron present his finds. And that meeting took place. Ron presented his finds. And the people suggested that Ron be contacted with the church's archaeologist. And so they sent a letter to Dr. William Shea, and I think he was working at Andrews University at that time. And he and Ron got together, and Ron took him places and showed him what he'd found. And Ron came back to work and told me that Bill Shea was really excited, that he just thought everything was great, and that repeatedly said that he couldn't wait to get home to tell about Ron's finds and share this. And I think they worked together for a time, but then the conference contacted Ron and said, Ron, it would be embarrassing to the church if it was found out that someone without an archaeology degree found all these things. And they said, let's let it be said that our archaeologist found these things, and Ron, we'll give you a church to pastor. And of course Ron would not agree.
What year was this?
I don't remember an exact time. It seems like probably in the, I don't remember exactly.
Was it the early 80s?
But it was a long time ago. It's in the 80s.
So in the 1980s.
Well, it may have been in the late 70s. Late 70s or early 80s.
O sea, parece ser que Ron al principio estuvo cooperando con la conferencia general, mostrando sus hallazgos. Y explicando a ver cómo podían ellos exponer todo lo que había encontrado al público para llegar a ellos, para advertir de la llegada de los últimos días. Y parece ser que al principio ellos reaccionaron bien, intentaron cooperar. Incluso había una persona en la universidad, William Shea, que estuvo con él trabajando, estuvo impresionado de estos hallazgos, pero de repente las cosas cambiaron y básicamente fue debido a que Ron no tenía un título en arqueología. Entonces todo esto podía suponer un poco sospechoso, un poco vergonzoso si alguna cosa no salía bien, y es cuando decidieron apartarlo un poco de todo lo que se suponía que tenían que hacer, que era mostrar la evidencia. Entonces fue este el motivo de por qué las cosas no fueron tal como tendrían que haber ido.
Según lo que contó el señor Ron, el Arca de la Alianza está en Jerusalén. ¿Reveló el sitio exacto de donde se encuentra el Arca? ¿De cómo llegar hasta ella con algún plano o descripción?
According to Ron, the Ark of the Covenant is located in Jerusalem. Did he tell the exact place where the Ark is located and how to get there with a map?
May I say something? You were talking about the Seventh-day Adventist Church. There are many, many individual people within the church that do believe wholeheartedly in these discoveries. My husband and I were allowed to go to the conference camp meeting last year and had a booth there to share the discoveries with a lot of people. You can't judge the entire church on a few individuals that wouldn't believe in it. And, you know, we know that our church is going to be cleansed before Jesus comes and the great multitude is going to come in. That may be a result of them seeing the Ten Commandments. And Dad was still a member of the Seventh-day Adventist Church when he died.
Bien, aquí Michelle nos hace un inciso de que no toda la gente de la Iglesia Adventista del Séptimo Día están evitando reconocer estos hallazgos, sino que hay mucha gente que sí que está siguiendo todas estas pruebas que se han ido encontrando durante estos últimos años por Ron, y sí que lo creen y están con él. O sea, no podemos hablar de tan solo una poca gente, sino que hay mucha que sí, que está de acuerdo con todos estos hallazgos. Y ella cree que la Iglesia Adventista será limpiada antes de la venida de Jesús, sobre todo con la muestra de los mandamientos en los últimos días.
Perfect.
Yeah, thank you, Michelle. So our question was about the location of the Ark. There was exact place where to find it in Jerusalem.
Are you wanting to know if we could point it out on a map? Is that your question?
Yes. Is it possible? Did the drone say where exactly was the Ark? That we should find it in located in a map today?
We could locate the area where we were digging for the Ark of the Covenant very easily. It was in the Garden Tomb where Christ was buried. You can go to the Garden Tomb anytime, and there's also other ways into the tunnel system from Zedekiah's cave. So the map, it would just show you a road that goes to the Garden Tomb. That's where we dug, and that's where the discovery was made.
I think isn't it, Ronnie, located near the escarpment
of the hill of Golgotha?
It's to the left of Golgotha, and before you get to the Garden Tomb, in between Golgotha, the place of the skull, and the Garden Tomb, is a rock escarpment that has some cutouts in it, where the signs were placed by the Roman soldiers when crucifying Christ. It's in that area there, underground, 25 or 30 feet from the surface, where the Ark is hidden in a cave.
Yep.
Entonces nos él nos indica que la el arca estaría en la zona donde Jesús fue crucificado y donde fue enterrado. Entre esa zona estaría localizada el arca en unas cuevas, en unos túneles subterráneos. ¿Ok?
¿Va a dejar algún plano? ¿Dejó algún plano para cómo llegar hasta ella?
Did you leave like a map with a if somebody would like to go and do some excavation to get there? Would it be possible to if somebody would go and excavate?
There's already been some excavations in the area in 2005 and 2006. The ark was not discovered, but I am certain it is still there. Ron had talked about some tunnels going from Zedekiah's cave over to the crucifixion site. And there have been some radar scans, and in 2005 and 2006, I believe, there were some resistivity scanning done, which proves it does show that there are voids in the area where Ron talked about the tunnel being there. So there is some proof.
Entonces sí que hay pruebas de que Ron estuvo ahí y haciendo las excavaciones en los túneles, pero no sabemos exactamente si hay un mapa que lo indica.
¿Está el gobierno de Israel al tanto de todo el asunto del Arca de la Alianza?
Is the government of Israel aware of the discovery of the Ark by Ron?
Yes, they are.
Yeah, absolutely.
But they deny it.
They won't admit to it. Just for political reasons, I think that they probably have a good idea where it is also.
Entonces ellos sí que lo saben, el gobierno de Israel lo sabe, pero por razones políticas lo están denegando.
In 1995, they attempted to move the ark. In our DVD, Ron mentions that a few years earlier that there were six Kohathites, or men from the tribe of Levi, from the Kohath family, dressed in Levitical garb, that went up a tunnel out of Zedekiah's cave toward the Ark of the Covenant cave. They made it 75 feet, and all, was it six of them, died?
Yep.
All six of them died. They were killed by the protecting angels, you know, that
protect
the ark.
It's a brain aneurysm.
Yeah, brain aneurysm. It looked like their eyes were crossed, and they called up Ron, and Ron had to drag their bodies out on rescue baskets one by one. So they know it's real. They were attempting to move it. They know it's hands off also because they're afraid of death. So if you were to ask them if it's been found, of course they'll laugh at you. They're not going to admit it publicly because it's a hot potato. You know, people are wanting to build the new temple, the third temple on the Temple Mount. This could lead to the Dome of the Rock being blown up. It's a very volatile topic. And right now, they don't know what to do because, you know, their men tried to retrieve it and they were killed. They don't know what to do at this point. But, of course, the Ark is resting in the area controlled by the Palestinians. It's in East Jerusalem. It's not on Jewish territory. That's another reason why they want to move it, to get over onto their side of the city. But anyway, God is in control, and in God's timing, you know, the Ten Commandments will come out, and there'll be a testimony to the world.
Entonces, ellos lo saben, el gobierno de Israel lo sabe, y ellos realmente no saben qué hacer con el arca porque se encuentra en territorio palestino. Les gustaría moverlos a su lado, pero el problema es que ya como pasó en el 1995, la intentaron mover y contrataron, había varias gente de la tribu de Leví intentando moverla. Entonces lo que pasó es que seis personas murieron, fueron muertas por el ángel protector del arca, de alguna manera muy concreta, muy especial, en la que quedaron bastante asustados. Entonces no, seguramente tienen miedo a volverlo a intentar y aunque ellos saben que está ahí el arca, no se atreven de momento a hacer nada con ella.
¿Tiene el gobierno israelita vigilada o controlada la zona donde se halla el arca? ¿Han manifestado ellos algo sobre el hallazgo?
Does the government of Israel control the area where the ark lies? Have they said anything about the discovery of the ark by Ron?
When the people that control the area where the ark is, have they said anything about the discovery by Ron?
No, the. Go ahead.
It's a church in England that actually owns the land there, the Garden Tomb property. The area also is considered Eastern Jerusalem, which is controlled by the Palestinians, also the government. But they don't acknowledge the Ark being there. The church out of England, they don't know about Ron's excavations and so forth.
Well, the garden people did let him, they allowed him to dig there.
Yeah, for years.
Yeah. The current people.
Right, right.
The current people are not familiar with Ron, but in the 1980s, of course, 1990s is when Ron was in good faith with those folks. They helped Ron with the excavation. They gave him permission. But the current people that are there don't know of Ron Wyatt. So if you were to ask them about Ron Wyatt, they don't really know him and would not, you know, endorse his find there.
Entonces la tierra donde se encuentra ahora el arca pertenece a la iglesia de Inglaterra y pero el territorio está es palestino, no forma parte de Israel. Entonces es una zona, parece ser un poco...
¿Es zona de iglesia anglicana?
Do you know what the specific charge from England is that owns the land there?
Anglicans.
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 And ellos no creen que falte un trono.
¿El gobierno de Israel ha manifestado algo sobre el hallazgo de algún modo?
Have the government of Israel have manifested the findings of Ron somehow?
No, none whatsoever.
I think they believe, but they don't want people to know it.
They won't admit it publicly.
So they are hiding everything.
Yes.
Yeah, but it would, when Ron was there, he would go directly to the Israel Antiquities people and ask them, hey, you got anything for me that I could do for you? And so they all knew him personally. But in fact, we've got pictures and videos of him talking to people that will, if you call them today and ask them if they know him, they'll say, no, we don't, we've never seen the man before. But we have the pictures of him showing, handing him even like a digging permit for the garden tomb, handing it right to him and standing there shaking his hand.
Ron would turn...
Hay pruebas, tienen fotografías y vídeos de Ron hablando con personas de Israel y grandes cargos, pero incluso con esto ellos lo niegan y siempre que oyen de Ron dicen que no lo conocen, básicamente.
Ron would turn over artifacts to the Israel Antiquities Authority, so that was back in the, you know, in the 80s. Especially like the ivory pomegranate, and so they knew that he had found something and they knew they could trust him basically. But a lot of those people are not in the Israel Antiquities Authority today, but there are some people, you know, in the government, in the IAA, that you know, do believe in the discovery of the Ark. They do, you know, believe in Ron Wyatt, but if you were to ask them, they would deny everything.
Ron told me that he turned over many boxes filled with artifacts to the museum and that they just stacked them in the basement or in their work area and didn't even bother to go through them.
Entonces Ron encontró un montón de de objetos muy interesantes que nunca le dieron importancia, entonces se quedaron almacenadas en algún sitio sin que nadie las quisiera.
Tengo entendido, he visto en una filmación, que el rabino que está intentando moverlo todo para reconstruir el tercer templo de Jerusalén, creo que se llama Chaim Richman, dice que ellos tienen localizada el arca, que por eso no la intentan reconstruir al igual que han hecho con los otros objetos que había en el templo. ¿Sabéis si realmente es cierto? ¿Los que pertenecen a este grupo tienen localizada el arca?
Well, we have heard that somebody with the name of
Chaim
Richman, somebody trying to build the third temple in Jerusalem,
no van a reconstruir ellos el arca porque la tienen localizada.
No.
Y en cambio han reconstruido todos los otros objetos.
We watched a video. They were trying to rebuild all the objects of the third temple for when it's time the temple to be built again, but they said they would not do anything with the ark. They would not rebuild the ark. Do you know anything about that?
They couldn't rebuild the ark.
They won't rebuild it.
They have said that they know where the ark is. They have announced that. They have everything ready to build the temple, everything, even to the priest's garments. They have everything except the ark, and they said they know where it is.
Ellos dicen que saben. Esta persona tiene la intención de reconstruir todo el templo, todos los objetos del templo, pero no tiene intención de reconstruir el arca, aunque sabe dónde está.
O sea, que ellos de seguro que sí saben dónde está el arca.
So they know for sure where the ark is.
Yes.
That's correct.
Yes. Ellos conocen exactamente dónde está el arca.
¿Cómo está la relación entre el Estado judío y ustedes? ¿Se han puesto en contacto con alguno de ustedes?
Is there any relationship between the State of Israel and you? Have they ever contacted you?
Have they ever contacted you?
No, not me.
No,
no,
no. No. No.
El señor Ron habló de que tomó muestras de sangre de sobre el propiciatorio, la tapa del arca. Sobre lo del análisis de esa sangre, que él dice que era de Jesús, ¿tiene el gobierno de Israel pruebas del resultado de ese análisis? Porque según el señor Wyatt, dice que era sangre viva después de unos 2000 años, tal como se muestra en esas imágenes de prueba de laboratorio, la cual cosa repercutiría muy duramente contra la religión judía, que no aceptó ni acepta a Jesús como el Mesías. ¿Han hecho ellos alguna declaración al respecto?
So, Ron mentioned that he took blood samples from the mercy seat of the ark, and that blood was supposed to belong to Jesus.
Yes.
Does the government of Israel have the results of that blood analysis? Because the results of that test would say that the blood was still alive after 2,000 years, as he showed in some images of a laboratory, would represent a very hard contradiction to the Jewish religion, which would not accept Jesus as the Messiah. Have they done any declaration about it?
The government doesn't have a copy of the blood test, as far as I know. I don't think they do. The initial test Ron had done there in Israel was after he took the Ten Commandments out of the Ark of the Covenant. The angel told Ron to have the blood tested. He took it to a lab there in Israel, and he videotaped them doing the testing. And as far as we know, he may have taken the test results, if there was a lab report, back to the cave when he returned the videotape of where he removed the Ten Commandments out of the Ark. That was videotaped. And it could be the blood testing in the lab was done on the same videotape. But so that videotape, the lab report, and the Ten Commandments, we think, are all sitting there in the cave.
Not very long, though.
To be presented to the world. Mm-hmm. As far as I know, I don't think the Israeli government has a copy of that blood test.
Sí, los resultados de los tests fueron hechos por Ron en Israel, pero seguramente el gobierno no tiene constancia de ello. Los resultados y algunas otras muestras fueron dejadas por Ron en la tumba donde se encuentra el arca, en la cueva, y allí serán encontradas el día que aparezca de nuevo el arca, como una prueba a nivel mundial de que Ron sí que hizo lo que el ángel le mandó que hiciera.
Ron no sacó ninguna copia de esas filmaciones al exterior, lo dejó todo en el arca.
Did Ron leave everything in the cave next to the ark, or he made some copies and take outside?
You mean the videotape, a copy of the videotape?
Or everything else that he left there.
I don't know. Different people have different opinions of that. Ron didn't tell me about. He told me he watched it before he left it there, or before he returned it. But I don't know of any copies, though some people think there are copies. Of course, the Israeli intelligence, they're very snoopy and know a lot of things, and they. Could very easily have the results of the blood from the laboratory. But I don't know.
Uh-oh.
What Ron left in the cave, if there was copies or whatever outside the cave that he took with him?
As far as we know, there are no other copies of it. I've heard a rumor that my dad gave a man a copy of it, but I don't know the man's name or who he was or anything. So that's all I've heard.
Ronnie has to leave in a few minutes. If you've got any special questions for him, he helped on the Ark of the Covenant dig with his father. If you've got any questions just for him, you want to address them right now.
Ronnie tiene que marcharse. Si tenemos alguna pregunta concreta para él, él fue quien excavó con su padre. Y...
Sí, básicamente, antes de que te vayas, me gustaría saber si, sabiendo que Wyatt parece ser que es un apellido de origen judío, si vosotros sois descendientes de la tribu de Leví, sabéis que tienen un cromosoma distinto. Me gustaría saber si vosotros os habéis hecho prueba de ADN para confirmar ese detalle.
He's asking if, knowing that the name Wyatt might be from Jewish origin, if you have ever done any genetic DNA testing to know if you belong to the tribe of Levi.
Yes.
They say they have an extra chromosome or something like that. So.
Yes. After my father died, there were people who were interested in his DNA, and so they came to me and tested my DNA to see if it turned out to be from the tribe of Levi. And in a way, it's weird. It didn't come from the tribe of Levi. It actually was from Judah.
Entonces, alguna gente estaba interesada en conocer el origen del ADN de Ron, y a través de su hijo, de Ronnie, se hizo las pruebas y salieron los resultados de que venía de procedencia de Judá, de la tribu de Judá, pero no de Leví.
Muy interesante. Bueno, una pregunta más antes de que te vayas. Sabemos que entró con Ron, con tu padre, entró a ver el arca, en la estancia donde está el arca, una persona que luego se parece ser que se fue corriendo y no quería volver allí. ¿Qué se sabe de este señor?
The question is, somebody else got in the cave with Ron, where the ark was, and it seems that man got scared and ran out of the cave. Do you know something about that man today? Is he alive? Where is he?
I don't know if he is still alive today or not. I really don't. I'm familiar with the story because my father just saw the look on his face, and he just said that he was just so scared. He had never seen anybody that scared.
I have a question for Ronnie. Ronnie, do you know of anyone else that ever made it into the cave or got to look into the cave after Ron opened it up?
To my knowledge, nobody got to look in onto the Ark of the Covenant. Since my father passed away, isn't it Wilbur Bishop's daughter?
Yes.
Or something said that Wilbur. There's a rumor that a good friend of my father's, Wilbur Bishop, went in there, but I don't know. I kind of doubt the validity of that story.
Entonces hay un... Él no sabe qué pasó con esa persona que entró con Ron, pero sí que conoce esta historia. Y Kevin ha preguntado a Ronnie si conocía a alguien más que hubiera entrado en la cueva, y dice que hay un rumor que corre que sí alguien fue, pero no sabemos si es una historia que ocurrió realmente. Uh-huh. Más bien un rumor.
Ronnie, ¿tú has vuelto allí?
That's a question for Ronnie, and is, did you go back there, that exact place, the Ark?
Have I been to the Ark of the Covenant?
Well, have you been after the excavations you did in the past? Have you gone back?
Yes, I was able to go back in 2005 and helped on an excavation. And then I was also back over there in 2007 just doing an interview by the dig in the Garden Tomb and the Red Sea crossing sites for some people in Norway. What's interesting about the excavation that I helped Wyatt Archaeological Research on is me and my brother and my father found the cross holes where Christ was crucified and the thieves in front of the cutouts where they placed the signs that said Jesus Christ, King of the Jews, and all that. And we found these three cross holes, and from the earthquake there was a crack that came down through the center of Christ's cross hole. And that's where Dad first got his first blood sample, was from the crack in that rock, even though it was very dirty, I'm sure, from just dirt. But we dug out those cross holes with our hands, and since that time, when we excavated, we covered those up because we thought that maybe the Israelites, Israelis might want to tear them up, because they don't necessarily believe in Jesus and the crucifixion and all. So we hid them, and to this day they have never been dug back up. And I think that would be a very good thing for someone to excavate and to show people so they could see where their Savior died.
I got a question for Ronnie. Ronnie, could you tell them about the experience your father had when his arm stuck up and he said, "There's Jeremiah's grotto"? Could you tell them you were there with them?
Yeah.
Just one second, let me translate it for. Ronnie nos dice que él estuvo en esa zona en los años 2005 y 2007, e incluso encontraron otros hallazgos importantes, como eran los agujeros donde habían crucificado, donde habían puesto las cruces de Cristo y los dos ladrones a su lado. Entonces esto fue otra cosa importante y él considera que todavía hay mucho más que encontrar ahí. Sería interesante que hubiera otro tipo de investigaciones en esta zona para encontrar más hallazgos.
Tengo entendido que los del Museo Wyatt están desde septiembre, consiguieron un permiso para acabar en la zona, en el túnel de Sedequías, ¿no? Sedequías.
He thinks that the people from the museum, you there, have a permit to do some excavations, and they've been doing it since September. Is that right?
What?
Oh,
they did a dig in Zedekiah's cave. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, they did not do a dig there at the Ark of the Covenant.
Teóricamente es el mismo lugar en uno de estos túneles donde se encuentra el arca, ¿no?
But that's the area where the ark is located.
The ark is not at Zedekiah's cave. There is a tunnel that leads from there 375 feet north up into the Garden Tomb grounds where the ark cave is located.
O sea, el arca de Sedequías no se encuentra en la cueva. Ahí el arca de la Alianza no está en la cueva de Sedequías, sino en un túnel que va más allá, hacia la tumba donde se enterró a Jesucristo.
Mm-hmm. Interesante. Bueno, pues Ron.
Can
you answer that Kevin's question, please?
Ronnie, can you tell them about your father's arm sticking out?
There was a time we went to the Garden Tomb. Sometimes when we went to Israel, they would be having something going on in the Garden Tomb, and sometimes we'd have to go somewhere else and find other things to do while they were having meetings and
what
stuff.
What year was this? What year? 78?
Probably 78 or 9. About 78 or 79, we were walking in the Garden Tomb. And we were just walking along, and some friend of a man was with us, and my brother and my dad, and we were walking along the sidewalk in there, and my dad's arm just reached up, and he goes, "That's Zedekiah's, Jeremiah's grotto, and the Ark of the Covenant's in there." And we looked over, and it was just a big trash heap. Where a pit where they had filled it with trash and like dead cats and rats, and it was just a mess. And that's when he first realized, and he didn't even know why he stuck his arm out. But we had been praying about God to show us what to do, and that was just how God answered his prayer. He showed him right to it. You know, it seemed like everything that my dad found, God led him right to it. So there was never any real problem. Even in the Red Sea, when we went for the golden chariot wheel, we found it right away. It's just amazing how God let people as untrained as we are to be a part of this.
Can you tell them about the taxi stopping three times, searching for Noah's Ark?
Oh, yeah. When we first went to Turkey...
Can you hold on one minute?
Oh, yes.
Ronnie nos cuenta un poco cómo iban encontrando estos hallazgos, como el arca, o como el carruaje, la rueda de carruaje en el Mar Rojo. Y parece ser que todo esto fue por inspiración divina. Incluso una vez Ron de golpe levantó su brazo indicando una dirección concreta donde había un montón de chatarra y de basura, y fue ahí exactamente donde se encontraba más abajo el arca. Entonces estos hallazgos fueron muchas veces descubiertos a través del Espíritu Santo en Ron.
¿Quieres añadir algo más?
Sí, there was another question, Kevin, you had?
About the taxi.
He was asking about the first trip when we went to look for Noah's Ark in Turkey, our very first trip overseas. When we got there, all we had was an aerial photograph from the book, the ARC file, and we didn't have like a compass or the map coordinates or anything or any way to know which direction to go once we got to Turkey. And we were on a train and going through all these mountains. And then we got down to the town Dugobazit or something like that. And we were driving in a taxi, and my dad said, "Guys, there is no way we're going to be able to know which direction to even start looking." And he said, "We really need to say a prayer that God will show us where to look or something, because we had no idea which direction." And shortly after we all three said a prayer, the taxi cab died on the side of the road. The lights went out and everything. The gas shut off. Everything just quit. And so we had to pull over. And we sat there for a while. And Dad said, "Well, guys, you know, that's kind of weird. It happened right after we prayed." So he told us to set up a big pile of rocks on the side of the road to mark where the car had stopped. And so we did that and sat there for a few minutes. And then the car just started back up. And so we drove on down the road a ways, and it died again. Lights went out and everything. And same thing again, we put a stack of rocks on the side of the road just in case. And so the car started back up again for no reason. And so we drove on, and then the third time it stopped. And we piled up the rocks again. And by that time we thought the car was just messed up, you know. And anyway, after that, we drove on back into town, and the next day, when we rented a cab and went back out to the rocks, that's where we hiked out from, and that's where we found the anchor stones and the graveyard where Noah's wife was buried. And we didn't quite get to Noah's Ark that first trip, but we were very close. But it's just amazing how God stopped that car right where it needed to stop to show us.
Well, parece ser que en un viaje a Turquía ocurrió algo muy interesante, y es que ellos no sabían exactamente hacia dónde dirigirse para empezar a buscar, encontrar lo que fuera, lo que estaban buscando, y entonces contrataron un taxi para recorrer diferentes caminos, y lo que iba sucediendo es que cada cierto tiempo el taxi se paraba, dejaba de funcionar, no sabían por qué, y entonces bajaban, de alguna forma amontonaban un montón de piedras, no sé exactamente por qué, y el taxi después volvía a funcionar, todos seguían otra vez una dirección, y de repente volvía a pararse. Entonces volvían a apilar unas rocas al lado de la carretera, y después el taxi volvía, continuaba su trayectoria, funcionaba correctamente, y volvieron a la ciudad. Entonces, al día siguiente, regresaron a esos lugares donde habían apilado las rocas, y eran zonas donde encontraron algunas cosas muy importantes, como fue la tumba de la mujer de Noé y varios otros hallazgos. Entonces, solo Dios sabe qué es lo que realmente ocurrió allí, pero fue algo que no se puede entender.
Muy interesante. Entonces, para ti no hay duda de que los descubrimientos de tu padre fueron totalmente dirigidos por Dios.
So, in your opinion, Ronnie, you are sure that the discoveries done by your father were think of the Holy Spirit?
Yes, most.
God guiding your dad.
He guided us every step. There is nothing we could have done without him. And without Dad raising us in our faith and praying, we could have never got close to finding any of this without God.
Entonces ellos, sin la ayuda de Dios, no podrían haber hecho nada de lo que hicieron. Solo con los estudios de Ron, su fe es lo que lograron, pero por sí mismos nunca hubieran podido hacer nada.
I'm sorry, but I have to leave. It was very nice to meet you, and I'm sorry I can't stay longer.
That's okay. Ronnie se tiene que ir. Siente mucho no poder continuar aquí, pero no puede seguir.
Thank you, Ronnie.
Thank you very much, Ronnie, for your time.
Thank you.
Del arca de la alianza, sabéis que últimamente han anunciado que se encontró el arca de Noé también, pero parece ser que nada tiene que ver con lo que encontró Ron. ¿Qué sabéis de todo esto?
We've heard lately in the news that somebody found Noah's ark somewhere, but it didn't have anything to do with Ron's findings. Do you know anything about that?
Well, a lot of people have done that, but this particular one, if you look into the news about it, they'll show that it's all fake. I think you're talking about the two Chinamen. Is that who you're talking about?
What's the name you mentioned?
It was the two Chinese men?
Yes, we're talking about that. So that's fake, that's been proven fake?
It's been proven fake, that's right.
O sea, el descubrimiento ha sido probado como falso. Estos dos hombres chinos,
This was over on Mount Ararat, and you can see a video on the internet of them knocking on this wood. It sounds like regular wood. Fresh wood. If it were really wood from Noah's Ark, it would be petrified. It was buried under snow. The very fact that you can hear it like regular wood is further proof, that it's a fraud. And someone in the group with them said that it was a fraud. But this is Satan's way of trying to confuse the issue, draw attention away from the real thing. This has gone on year after year where people claim they find the Ark over on Mount Ararat. The Mount Ararat is a post-flood volcanic mountain that came up after the flood. It's one of the last places you would want to look for Noah's Ark.
Entonces, cada año se repiten muchos de estos hallazgos falsos, y incluso en este último, cuando se golpeó la madera de lo que supuestamente era el arca, ya se veía que la madera no era lo que tendría que ser, ¿no? Que era petrificada, un fósil, el sonido que hacía parecía más bien una madera fresca, sin,
que no era antigua, ¿no? Another thing about the whole thing is that is a tremendous money making opportunity for Turkey. Especially those residents around the mountain, they expect these tourists and these ark seekers to come over there, a certain times of the year, and they bring all their cash, and they don't want the ark to be found. They still want to be looking for it.
Entonces esto también supone un gran negocio para Turquía anunciar que encuentran el arca porque hay un montón de turistas, hay un montón de dinero involucrado en todas estas noticias de este tipo.
Anteriormente hay una filmación en blanco y negro de un señor francés llamado Navarra que muestra que iba con su hijo y bajó a través de una montaña muy nevada, se metió hacia abajo en el hielo y consiguió extraer una madera de aproximadamente un metro, creo recordar, que tuvo que partir en distintos trozos y se los llevó. Y decía que era el arca de Noé. ¿Es eso cierto?
I have seen a videotape where there's a French man called Navarra, and he shows a videotape with his son finding the ark and showing that he took some of the wood from the ark and cut it into pieces. Are you familiar with that story, or have you heard anything about it?
Yes, that's from the mid 1900s. For what we understand, he took the wood up there the previous year and then came back and found it with this other group. Again, that's just a false story. that Satan has created to confuse the issue. It's not real.
Esto es una, se ve que esta persona ya tenía la madera desde hacía un año. Supuestamente después dijo que lo había encontrado en el arca, que pertenecía al arca, pero no es una, es una historia falsa que Satanás usa para confundir lo auténtico.
Y últimamente parece que salió un cable de WikiLeaks donde decían de que Estados Unidos, o el gobierno de Estados Unidos, fue a Turquía y se llevó el arca, no sé de qué modo, si por piezas o entera, no lo sé, pero parece que eso es una realidad. ¿Es así realmente o el arca sigue estando allí?
I heard the news from the WikiLeaks website, and they said that the U.S. government went and took the ark back to the States. Do you know if that's right?
Speaking of Noah's Ark.
Yes. We've heard something like that.
No, that's false. They're going to be building a replica, you know, various. But the real thing is still sitting over there, in across the valley from Mount Ararat at Noah's Ark National Park. It's still sitting there.
O sea, el arca todavía se encuentra ahí, donde está, y lo que sí quieren hacer es una réplica del arca. Es lo que tienen pensado hacer.
Volviendo al tema del Arca de la Alianza y a la persona que hemos dicho antes que sabemos que parece ser que entró con Ron y que luego se fue, ¿se sabe el nombre de esta persona?
Going back to the Ark of the Covenant and that history of that man who went with Ron inside the cave and suddenly he left, he ran out. Do you know the name of that individual?
No, that was an Arab man, a small Arab man that was helping Ron on the dig, and he was the first person to crawl inside the cave, and he just got terrified. God scared him out of there, and he scurried out, and I don't guess he really saw anything. The Ark of the Covenant was still in a stone box. There were still all these stones and boards inside the cave, but he was just scared to death, and God basically scared him out of the cave to get him out of the way, and then Ron was able to open up the hole larger, and Ron was able to crawl into the cave after that.
Ron said the young man didn't see anything because it was dark. He said Ron was fixing to hand him his flashlight so that he could shine it around and look and see if he could find anything. But before he could even put his flashlight in for the young man, he got scared and left. And I think the last thing Ron knew, he went to Jordan and he never saw him again.
Me parece ser que el señor era un hombre árabe, joven, que no se sabe más de él, pero de repente fue, se marchó, incluso sin ver el arca. El arca estaba cubierta por maderas o piedras o que fuera, y parece que fue una señal de Dios para que este hombre marchara enseguida, y él se fue con mucho miedo fuera de la cueva.
Y ahora una pregunta que creo que todo el mundo que está pendiente de este tema está esperando. Dijo Ron, el momento en que el arca saldría a la luz, ¿en qué fecha y por quién saldría a la luz?
So one of the questions we really like to know, and we think many of the people who are listening to us would like to know, is if did Ron mention specific date about when the ark would be shown, and who would show it?
When the ark would be shown.
Ron said that the time of the Sunday law, when the Sunday law comes. At the Ten Commandments.
Mark of the Beast.
The angel in the cave said that when the mark, the angel in the cave said when the Sunday law is enforced, then the Ten Commandments will be shown
Ron
to the world.
The angel said Sunday law, but that he said law.
So we're waiting for the Sunday law, and we're waiting for the Sunday law to be enforced. That would be a penalty would be instituted. And that's the time when the Ten Commandments will come out. The videotape of Ron removing the Ten Commandments out of the Ark will also come out. We're hoping that video of the blood testing being done will also be on that tape. And we're hoping the lab report will also come out. We don't know who's going to bring it out. Someone said that Ron told them that an angel was going to bring them out. Whether that's true, we don't know. It's not been confirmed. But God is in control of it. And in his timing, it'll be shown to the world and will be a testimony to everyone. Because everyone on earth will be judged. The living will be judged of every religion. And everyone will have to confess their sins in Jesus' name and start obeying the Ten Commandments in order to be saved. That's everyone of every religion. So God has this incredible evidence prepared to show everyone on earth, because you're going to either receive the mark of the beast or the seal of God. In order to receive the seal of God, you've got to be obeying the Ten Commandments through faith in Jesus and the Holy Spirit. And so God has this incredible evidence ready to show the world.
Entonces, no podemos saber una fecha exacta, pero sí podemos saber que cuando aparezca la ley dominical, que vendrá después la aparición de los diez mandamientos, y esto vendrá a ser la marca de la bestia, en esa época saldrá lo que es el arca, para que el mundo vea el testimonio de Cristo y puedan tener la elección de elegir entre obedecerle, obedecer a Dios y los diez mandamientos y ser sellados, o no hacerlo y morir y no poder salvarse.
Esto sabemos que Helen White lo escribe en sus citas, que se va a mostrar el arca en el cielo, se abrirá el cielo, veremos el arca con los mandamientos, mostrándose el cuarto mandamiento brillando especialmente. Pero también hay citas donde, como bien dice Kevin, parece ser que se va a mostrar el arca que está aún en la cueva. Esto es muy interesante porque realmente es marcar, como bien dice, el momento de decisión de cada ser humano que esté sobre la tierra, sobre la marca de la bestia. Pero, ¿esto también lo dijo Ron? ¿O lo sabemos solo por Helen White?
So what you said, Kevin, is we can read that in Ellen White's readings, and she also talks about God is going to show the ark in the sky, the heaven, and also the fourth commandment, especially the Saturday, and the ark is going to be shown also here on earth.
The Ten Commandments, Mrs. White said that when the spurious Sabbath is set up, the Ten Commandments that Moses put in the Ark will be shown to the world as a testimony against the spurious Sabbath. And so it's those Ten Commandments that Ron removed from the Ark that will be shown to the world. Mrs. White speaks of another set of Ten Commandments, perhaps the Ten Commandments from heaven, I don't know, they'll be shown in the sky. That's the original set that may be shown after that, maybe after the close of probation, we don't know. But the Ten Commandments are going to be shown, and someone has to find them for them to be shown, and that man was Ron Wyatt.
So
bueno, básicamente me interesa saber si Ron dijo también esto, o solo lo sabemos por Helen White, que el arca saldrá a la luz en estos momentos sobre la disputa entre sábado y domingo.
Okay. So he wants to know if Ron also said that when the Sunday law comes, that the ark was going to show up, or it was just Helen White who said that. Did Ron know also that?
Dad said that the Ten Commandments would be shown, not the Ark. He's recorded on video stating that he thought that the ark may stay where it is forever as a testimony to the sacrifice that Jesus made for our sins so that we could live.
So we are not going to see the ark, but we will see the Ten Commandments?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. We'll probably see it on video. We'll see it on video, and we'll see the blood testing, and we'll see the Ten Commandments themselves. But Ron said, like Michelle said, that it'll stay in that cave perhaps permanently. And he said it could be incorporated into the new temple here on earth, and where the 144,000 can enter. And they will be able to see the blood that they talked about when they gave the loud cry to planet Earth, asking people to give their hearts to the Lord. They will be able to see that very blood that they were trying to plead with the world, you know, to give their hearts to Jesus. And so that'll be a privilege to them, this evidence of the atoning sacrifice that will be preserved forever there in the basement of the temple or some way or another. So in effect, Ron was like a high priest that was allowed to go into that cave and bring out a report to the world of what God has done. We don't need a second witness. The high priest in Moses' day was believed. He came out with a testimony. And so Ron's credibility was established with all these four other major discoveries. And when he says that he saw this in the cave, we should believe him. That's the most logical thing, is to believe his testimony and not doubt it.
So we are not going to, whoever is going to live in the last days, they're not going to see the ark.
They'll at least see it on video, and it'll be shown around the world. That's why we have technology today. God has allowed this technology to develop, such as television, satellite, because he's going to force all this information across the airwaves. People will see video of the Ark of the Covenant. They'll see the Ten Commandments perhaps in person as it tours around the world. But God's preparing this as a witness. We don't have to necessarily see the Ark of the Covenant in person, but the Ten Commandments will be a testimony to the world, and the blood of Jesus will validate those Ten Commandments. It'll be totally unique, and that will validate all the discoveries, that blood. And people will say, who's this man on video we see in the cave with the Ark of the Covenant? Well, that's Ron Wyatt. What else did he work on? Well, he worked on Noah's Ark, Red Sea Crossing, Mount Sinai, Sodom and Gomorrah. So everything Ron touched will be validated through this evidence coming out in the last days. And so God has this as a tremendous witness to show planet Earth.
Básicamente nos dice que los diez mandamientos sí que podremos verlos, pero el arca será vista solo a través de las pruebas que Ron dejó en la cueva, y que a través de estas pruebas será mostrada el arca a todo el mundo. Entonces, esta es la tecnología que supuestamente se usará para que la gente vea lo que ocurrió con Ron.
O sea, que el arca no saldrá a luz, serán solo los 10 mandamientos?
Well, again, the question is, the only thing we will be able to see ourselves are the Ten Commandments, but not the arca.
That's what we believe. We'll see it on video, like I said.
They keep talking about the actual ark coming out. It's not going to happen.
The actual ark itself is not going to come out, as far as we know.
Que el arca no saldrá nunca más. De lo que ellos saben hasta ahora, dicen que el arca nunca más se verá.
Tengo entendido también de que él dijo de que la Shekinah, la gloria de Dios, aún se manifiesta sobre el propiciatorio. ¿Es así?
Did John say that the Shekinah, the God's glory, was still above the mercy seat?
Yes. Yes, he said the Shekinah.
The Shekinah glory is no longer there.
No, he said it is not.
It's not.
No, no se encuentra ahí.
Vale. ¿Hay algo que quieran añadir que crean que es interesante que conozcamos?
Would you like to add something else that you feel it's interesting for us to know? Would you like to add something?
I was going to tell you about the his description of where the ark rests in the cave is setting against a crystal rock. And when you shine a light, it's got a rainbow that goes across it. And what's interesting to me about it being setting underneath a crystal rock is, when I was a child, I used to have one of those little bitty crystal radios where you would take a needle, and if you were close to a radio station, you could stick a needle in that crystal rock, and you could hear music or talking through your needle as it stuck in the rock. So I think my personal feeling about that is, with that arc setting underneath that crystal rock, that crystal absorbs all these radio sound waves that they're trying to shoot down into the ground to find the arc. It absorbs it so they can't even see it.
Okay, so parece ser que nos hay una el arca está rodeado como unas rocas de un tipo de cristal que hacen aíslan el arca de las señales que mandan las máquinas o de cualquier aparato que esté intentando encontrarlo. De alguna manera es como algún tipo de elemento protector del arca que está alrededor de él.
¿Sabéis si hay algún asentamiento judío de colonias que se estén construyendo precisamente en dirección hacia donde se encuentra el arca?
Do you know if there's any like Jewish colonies trying to establish in the direction where the ark is supposed to be? Do you know if they are going there somehow?
Well, the whole area is surrounded with Arab territory at this time.
El lugar está rodeado por zona árabe, todo ese territorio.
Respecto a la muestra de sangre que se extrajo de la sangre de Jesús, en una filmación se ve que la cogen, parece ser que en polvo, y la ponen en una solución líquida. ¿Quién tiene ese botecito con estas muestras de la sangre?
We saw a videotape showing the analysis of the blood samples. And there's something like transferring some dust sample into a little small bottle of liquid thing. Do you know if there's somebody have those samples?
Is that Richard Reeves' test?
Yeah.
Yes. That wasn't proven to be Jesus.
No.
That was a test that Richard Reeves did, and that has not been proven to be Jesus' blood, so it's probably best if we don't talk about that, you know, to the public.
Okay, so estas pruebas, estas muestras, parece ser que las hizo Richard Reeves y no están autentificadas.
O sea, que podía ser un montaje?
So it could be a fake thing?
Or they could be misled or mistaken, you know, about that.
That blood wasn't taken from... The blood the sample that Richard Reeves and Mary Nell had was not taken from the Ark of the Covenant. What was taken from the Ark of the Covenant that Ron took to the laboratory was definitely the blood of Jesus. The chromosomes were counted. Ron said, I know that dried blood is dead blood, and you cannot get a chromosome count from dead blood. He and I worked together in the hospital, and he said, Jocelyn, it was not my idea to take a blood sample and have it analyzed. He said it was the angel's idea. The angel told me to take a blood sample and take it and have it analyzed and check for chromosome count. He took the blood to a laboratory in Jerusalem, and they reconstituted it, and he asked them to tell him what they could, and they said it's human blood, and then when he asked them to do a chromosome count, they said no, we can't. And that's what Ron would have thought, except that a heavenly being told him to get a chromosome count. So he wouldn't take no for an answer. He kept asking them to do a chromosome count.
finally they said, okay. And then they did the, they actually did it, and then Ron asked to be there when they checked it out. And it showed that, well, they put some in a growth medium, and the white cells divided in the dish. They could see the white cells dividing under the microscope. And they knew that was not normal, and they about went crazy. Anyway, they asked Ron whose blood it was, because it only had 23 chromosomes and one wife, 24 chromosomes all total, 23 from the mother, which was all a mother could give her child, 23. So Mary gave him all of the chromosomes possible. He had one wife from the father, which was not a human father. And then Ron, they asked Ron, whose blood is this? And he said, it's the blood of your Messiah. And he said they about went crazy. And that he took his report and left. And someone asked whether that his answer changed their minds, whether they were converted over that. And he said, how would I know? I took my report and left. But later on, he made the statement that their lives were changed. And so he went back again and to see those people in the laboratory.
Aquí nos cuenta un poco, Jasmine, lo que nosotros habíamos preguntado. Este señor, Richard Reeves, en este vídeo nos mostraba la sangre de Jesús. Y esto lo hizo Ron en un laboratorio de Israel. Y al principio no quisieron averiguar la cuenta de cromosomas, pero después lo hicieron y quedaron todos de piedra, ¿no? Al saber que había un cromosoma menos, que sería del Padre, de Dios. Y entonces le preguntaron de a quién pertenecía esa sangre. Él le respondió que la había encontrado ahí en el arca, que era de Jesús, y que ellos se quedaron pues sin poder decir nada y muy sorprendidos.
¿Hay nombres o testimonios de las personas que junto a Ron analizaron esta sangre? ¿Fueron testimonios directos porque ellos fueron los que hicieron este análisis?
Do we know the names of the people who did that blood analysis, who showed the chromosome count different from ours?
No, it was some lab in Israel, but Ron has kept that secret, which has been, that's been good that he's kept it secret.
No conocemos los nombres, pero creemos que Ron hizo bien al ocultar los nombres.
Bien, lo que antes ha dicho Ronnie de que se hizo las pruebas de ADN y él no pertenece a la tribu de Leví, verdaderamente puede ser muy significativo, porque entonces quiere decir que cualquier persona que Dios crea conveniente puede llegar a acercarse hasta ese arca. O, con lo cual queda, como parece ser que indica el texto bíblico, que ya no hay más pacto antiguo en este sentido, y a partir de allí ya no hace falta ser levita para llegar a tocar el arca.
What Ronnie said is very significant, because if he belongs to the tribe of Judah instead of Levi as the DNA group, can we think that the people who can get closer to the Ark or to God is not anymore the people from the tribe of Levi as the Old Testament says? Now, do you think that the New Testament, we can all be closer to God, not only the people from the tribe of Levi?
I don't quite get the question.
It's a little difficult to explain, but mm-hmm. Did you understand?
No, I didn't understand the question.
Well, we're all spiritual Jews now. If you're of Christ, Galatians 4, if you're of Christ, you're of Abraham's seed. So, and of course, the ceremonial system is no longer, you know, active. But Ron, you know, was a faithful follower of Jesus, and he had the credentials to go in there. He was a Ten Commandment keeper, and that was important. God chose someone that was humble and faithful, and that was, you know, what Ron was, and that was the criteria God was looking for. Not of blood necessarily, but of a good heart.
Entonces, Ron era un gran creyente, seguidor de Cristo, seguidor de los mandamientos, y esto es lo que Dios pide. Entonces, no creemos que por ser de sangre de la tribu de Leví tuviera más oportunidades. No creemos que sea así.
Entonces, supongo que precisamente de estos detalles, los servicios secretos judíos deben estar al tanto de que Ron no era de la tribu de Leví. Por tanto, ¿sabéis si han vuelto a intentar ellos acercarse, aunque no sea con levitas, a intentar extraer el arca?
Well, since Ron was not of the tribe of Levi, and he could get really close to the ark, and the government of Israel tried to get closer to the ark with those six people that were from the tribe of Levi. Do you know they changed their opinion now of who can get closer? Or is this?
We don't know. As far as we know, I don't believe that they've ever tried to send anyone else in there. I would want to tell you, though, that Dad didn't really try to publicize any type of DNA or any heritage of his own. It's just basically, you know, he said he was willing to do it and no one else stepped up. We have a video of him on our website that he states that he just fell over things and found them just because God could use him. I mean, you know, we're told in the Bible, if you are Christ, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. So the blood heritage for us is not important. It's your belief in Christ that saves you, not your blood.
Entonces, básicamente, nos dice que ella no sabe si los israelitas han mandado más gente en busca del arca, sabiendo que Ron no era de la tribu de Leví, pero que el asunto de la sangre ya no es nada importante una vez se conoce a Cristo y se sigue, se obedece lo que Él quiere que hagamos. O sea, se ha roto ese enlace que había antes entre el ministro sagrado de la tribu de Leví y después de Cristo, con nosotros.
El pacto de oficial.
El pacto de oficial.
Y ahora una pregunta quizás muy personal. ¿Cuánto tiempo creéis que falta para que esto salga a la luz, hasta que aparezca esta ley dominical que provoque esta situación? Sé que es una pregunta muy personal, pero a ver qué opinión tenéis vosotros.
We'd like to know your opinion. That's a personal opinion about when the Sunday law is gonna come for us. When do you, as kind of specific date or 5, 10 years? What do you think?
We don't know. For myself, I don't know, but you know, Mrs. White says that the natural disasters will increase, and there'll be a call for Sunday laws. So things are going to get rough, and people are going to think we need to get back to God, and they think that this will be the solution. But it'll bring on, you know, the wrath of God, basically, and the Ten Commandments will come out after that. So I don't know a timeline.
Ron didn't believe in time setting. He didn't predict anything.
No one knows when that's going to happen, and that's the reason why everyone needs to be ready now. So you'll be ready when it does come.
No sabemos exactamente una fecha, pero esto no es lo importante. Lo importante es estar preparados ahora y para lo que tenga que venir.
Estoy completamente de acuerdo. Os lo digo porque es una pregunta que me hacen muy a menudo a mí. Y seguramente al saber de este tema aún se la van a hacer más.
I completely agree with you, but I had to ask that question because many people is asking me, so I had to know your opinion on that.
Bien, no sé si quieren añadir alguna otra cuestión.
We'd like to ask you if you have any other thing you'd like to add, any other issue we should know, we should tell people.
Most people don't understand that in that cave where the ark is, it's not just the ark. Ron found the entire wilderness tabernacle.
He found the entire?
Such as.
Yes. There was the table of showbread and its utensils and the golden candlestick and the altar of incense and the censer. And he found two ephods and a sword that was about 5 feet and 2 inches long, and a curtain.
Is
and
it a veil? You think it's a veil?
I asked him what the curtain was made of. He said, I don't know, I didn't have time to unfold it. One of the most interesting things I thought was when he talked about the boards of the tabernacle, the golden boards that the Bible talks about that are wide and tall, very tall, about 17 feet, I think, something like that. He said, Jesslyn, I used to wonder, where did they find acacia trees big enough to make boards that size? And he said they didn't. They took pieces and put them together. They didn't plane them. They didn't make them smooth. They were still bumpy. Put pieces together, clamp them together, and overlay them with gold. The boards are there. What else was in there?
Some priest robes.
Ron didn't tell everybody the same thing. He didn't tell me about every detail, and he didn't tell most people about very many things. There was an earthen vessel in which he said contained the deed of Jeremiah. But the boards, he said the boards, even though they weren't plain, they were bumpy, he said they were very beautiful. I told him I'd been to a World's Fair and saw some very ancient gold, and it was somewhat tarnished, and I asked if the golden furniture in there was tarnished, and he said no. It was very simple and very beautiful. It all had a bell and a pomegranate theme. There were bells and pomegranates all the way around the Ark of the Covenant and the Table of Showbread and the Altar of Incense and the censer, and I assumed the candlestick. He didn't tell me about the candlestick until I asked if it was there, and he said yes, and it's tall. And I asked whether the branches were flat, like the way most people, the artists draw them, and he said no. How else could you walk among them? So the candlestick was like this and not like this.
So why do you think all those objects are important?
Well, because I think they were waiting under the cross site because of the covenant. Moses had ratified the old covenant. Christ needed to ratify the old covenant. And when the blood came down from the cross hole cut out in stone and down through the crack, and the ark was in a stone box with the lid broken back, the poles weren't in that box, but the poles were in the cave. When the blood dripped on the broken lid and splashed off onto everything there. Everything got the blood of Jesus on it. And then the blood went through the break and down and puddled on the mercy seat, mostly on the westward side of the mercy seat.
because the blood of bulls and goats went to the eastward side. The Moses, when Moses ratified the covenant, he killed a bull and a goat. He took the blood and sprinkled all through the holy place and most holy place, everything in the wilderness tabernacle. And then he reserved blood to sprinkle on the people. And Christ had to do the same thing antitypically as the priest did typically. So he had to ratify the first covenant by sprinkling his blood all through the same wilderness tabernacle that Moses built in the desert of Arabia. That was God's throne was in the wilderness tabernacle. When Solomon built the temple, the furnishings of the wilderness tabernacle were used. The entire wilderness tabernacle was furnished in Solomon's temple, all of it, not just the ark. And then it was hidden by orders of King Josiah. And when Solomon's temple was destroyed and the people were 70 years in captivity, when they came back and built the second temple, it did not have any of the furnishings of the original wilderness tabernacle, because they were all hidden in the cave under the cross.
Okay, so lo que nos está contando de manera resumida es que en el lugar donde se encuentra esa arca, no solo estaba la arca, sino un montón de objetos muy interesantes, como puede ser una espada, una cortina, un velo, un sitio donde poner incenso y velas,
el incensario, el candelabro.
Había un montón de objetos que tenían que dar prueba de que todo eso se había encontrado en el primer y en el segundo tabernáculo ya construidos anteriormente, en donde la sangre de Jesús iba a ser esparcida entre esos elementos para salvarnos a nosotros, como imagen de lo que él vendría a hacer cuando viniera a la tierra.
¿El candelabro de siete brazos también estaba allí dentro?
Did you talk about the candle, the thing that holds the candles? What name was that you said?
Golden candlestick.
Yeah, the golden candlestick. Do you know if it had seven branches?
Seven.
Yes, seven.
Yes. Siete. Tenía siete ramas el candelabro.
Lo digo porque en un grabado que aparece en un arco de triunfo, si no recuerdo mal, se ve como alguien se lleva el candelabro de siete brazos como un trofeo del templo de Jerusalén. ¿Cómo entendemos eso entonces? ¿Que se llevaron una copia?
But I remember in a picture somebody there was like an icon of somebody taking that candle away from the temple.
Yes,
you said that they stole from the temple some objects, but the objects were inside the cave.
There were two different occasions, at least, that things were taken from the temple. The Babylonians took them, and then Titus took things. But when Solomon made the temple, he made more furniture. He didn't have just what was from the wilderness tabernacle. He made golden tables and lots of candlesticks. I think scripture says 10 candlesticks and vessels. There were lots of extra things in Solomon's temple. But they did not take the things that were from the wilderness tabernacle. On the Arch of Titus, there is pictured a candelabra, a short one. But there were many. Solomon had many of those. He even made two extra angels that went into the most holy place. great angels that were about 17 feet tall. So there were extra things.
Aún si puede verse esta imagen que menciona Víctor, el templo que Salomón reconstruyó tenía un montón de cosas que él hizo construir. Incluso se menciona que algún ángel de una estatura muy elevada también creaba objetos de este tipo. Entonces, había un montón, y aunque esta imagen mostrara a alguien que se lo llevara, había muchas más.
Hablando de ángeles, Ron dice de que, o testimonió de que cuando él entró al arca había dos ángeles, ¿no?, custodiando el arca. ¿Es así?
When talking about angels, we've heard that Ron mentioned that two angels were in the ark's place. Do you agree with that?
No. Four angels. Not two. Four. Ron said they told him that they had been with the ark ever since Moses put the commandments in there. One of the four angels talked with Ron. The others never did. But the one angel that talked to him didn't answer all of his questions. Those four angels took hold of the mercy seat and lifted it up for Ron to and said Ron should take the Ten Commandment stones out. So that there were four angels.
Entonces había cuatro ángeles y solo uno de ellos habló con Ron y tampoco quiso responderle todas las preguntas que Ron le formulaba.
¿Aún están allí esos ángeles? Se supone que sí, ¿no?
Do you think those angels still there?
Yes. They're protecting the ark.
You'll be able to see them on the video. The angels show up on the video.
But they look like people dressed in street clothes.
Dressing street clothes?
Yes.
Y que visten ropas de calle.
O sea, que visten ropa como cualquiera de nosotros.
Like street clothes, like ours?
Yes, yes. Ron's had several encounters with angels during his work and during his life. He said 16 angels he'd seen at least. Mm-hmm. And each time he saw one, they were like a regular person. But that's just God's way, you know, of communicating and working with us.
Dice que Ron encontró alrededor de 16 ángeles en su vida y que ellos se parecían mucho a nosotros. No podíamos distinguirlos de nosotros o cualquier otro. Pero yo creo que para eso nos vídeos.
Bien, será bueno poder disponer de esos vídeos para poderlos mostrar a las personas, ¿no? Porque esos vídeos están en vuestra posesión.
No, you said the two angels appear on the videos?
On the video. Somebody asked Ron, did the angels show up on the video? See, Ron put his tripod up. In fact, when he came into the cave that time, when he first saw the angels, he had a video camera and tripod. And the angel told him to set up the tripod and put the camera on it and turn it on.
And but the videos are the ones that are stored in the cave.
That's the one. And someone asked if the angel showed up, and he said yes. And I asked whether that crystal wall that's about 18 feet tall, that's behind the ark, that emanates colors of the rainbow, I asked him if that showed up. And he said, everything showed up.
Entonces dice que los ángeles mandaron a Ron grabarlos. Y que esas cintas son las que dejó Ron en la cueva para que se encontrasen más adelante.
O sea, que de esas no tenéis copia.
So we don't have copies of those tapes showing the angels there.
No.
Ron said when the time comes, there's about five places around the world who will receive copies of those, and then it will be quickly spread around the world. He said everybody will get to see it on international television.
Entonces habrá alrededor de 5 lugares en el mundo que recibirán copias de estas cintas y se podrán mostrar desde allí a todos los habitantes de las zonas.
Pero entonces, ¿alguien tiene estas copias para que se muestren?
And who do you think is gonna send the videos to those 5 locations so people can see the videotapes?
I don't know.
I think the Seventh-day Adventist Church will definitely be involved in showing that evidence to the world.
Creemos que la Iglesia Adventista del Séptimo Día estará involucrada en el momento de mostrar esas cintas. De alguna manera las recibirán y las mostrarán a la gente.
Pero esto supongo que es una suposición personal, ¿no?
Michelle, that's your thought, your opinion?
Just my personal opinion. I think that this message is part of the third angel's message, and it was given to God's remnant church as a message to his children on this earth so they can be saved.
I too think it's part of the third angel's message, is from the part that keep the faith of Jesus. We're told that the third angel says, "Hear they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus." We've taught the commandments of God, and it's the faith of Jesus part that is going to go. This is part of that message.
These 10.
Creemos que esto es el forma parte del mensaje del tercer ángel. Esto es lo que tiene que ocurrir. Y Michelle ha dicho que su opinión personal es lo que ha mencionado.
The 10 commandments coming out back up those who are giving the loud cry. It's evidence, hard evidence, right in front of people, a show and tell demonstration of the truth that the 10 commandments are real, and God is bringing them out at a special time when the Sunday law is being pushed around the world that is against the 10 commandments. So this is going to be ammunition for those who are faithful and are willing to stand up for the truth in at the time when people are being persecuted. Those who are standing up for the truth, 144,000, will all be talking about the 10 commandments, the blood of Jesus. So, this is ammunition for those who are going to be faithful for the Lord.
Entonces, la aparición de los 10 mandamientos en tiempos de la ley dominical servirán sobre todo para mostrar al mundo de que una cosa contradice la otra. Y entonces sabremos cuál es la verdadera a través de estas tablas, de las leyes, de los mandamientos.
Bien, podría estaros preguntando muchas horas, muchas, pero creo que básicamente lo esencial ha salido ya aquí. Os he intentado formular preguntas que todas las personas que hemos sabido algo sobre este tema nos hemos planteado. Y os quiero agradecer profundamente el que hayáis hecho esta buena voluntad hacia nosotros para concedernos esta entrevista.
I could be asking you many, many more questions, but I think it's time to stop right here. And we really appreciate your time. I hope we can spread the message to everyone. And I don't know, if there's anything you'd like to add here?
I'd like to say something about the Ark of the Covenant. Like Jesselyn mentioned, the blood of bulls and goats was cast toward the east. The priests were told that. There was a vacant western side that was not touched. That was waiting for the blood of Jesus to be applied there one day. And if the Jews had been faithful, they would have kept the Ark of the Covenant. Babylon would not have sacked their city. And when Jesus came, they would have embraced Jesus as their Messiah. Everything would have been beautiful. And one day Jesus would have come in and said, "I am the sacrifice today, not that lamb." And his blood would have been taken in to the Ark of the Covenant and applied to the western side. That's how God would have done it. But they were disobedient. They were rebellious. God sent the Babylonian army there as a punishment, and the ark was taken from them, and it was hidden 600 years before Christ. And God, in his wonderful planning, protected it, Jesus was crucified directly above it, not by accident, but this was God's plan, the location, and God's beautiful plan of the blood going on the Ark of the Covenant did happen. It's a real thing, and it's a beautiful testimony that the world will hear about and will be there forever in that cave. And we thank Jesus for the wonderful sacrifice.
Yeah, read Leviticus 11:17 really close. Or 17:11, I'm sorry. Leviticus 17:11 is an eye-opener if you read it really close and study each line carefully and how each word is put in the sentence.
The life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you upon the altar, for it is the blood that maketh an atonement for the soul. And then Daniel 9:24, to bring in the everlasting righteousness and to seal up the vision and prophecy and to anoint the most holy. Christ said, I've given it to you upon the altar. And Daniel said, and to anoint the most holy.
Yeah, that Daniel 9:24, go with that real carefully. An atoning sacrifice, put an end to sin, bring in everlasting righteousness. This is talking about Jesus' blood atoning for our sins. And that was to happen within the 70 weeks, and it did. So Daniel 9:24 was predicting this blood atoning, putting an end to sin, and that did happen.
And the whole verse was talking about the crucifixion.
Okay, so bueno, nos han hablado primero de todo sobre el arca fue robada por Babilonia de los judíos porque no obedecieron a Dios, y justamente ese arca fue enterrada en el sitio donde tendría que estar crucificado Cristo, para que la sangre bajara desde la cruz hacia el arca, descendiendo por el agujero donde la montaña se quebró en aquel momento. Entonces todo esto es un gran testimonio de Cristo, de lo que vino a hacer por nosotros. Y también comentan algunas citas bíblicas como Daniel 9:24 sobre algunos aspectos que tendremos que traducir en más detalle.
There are several translations that actually use the word atone or atonement there in that verse. Look up various translations of that verse. It's very powerful what's said there.
And that's for Daniel 9:24?
Yes.
Okay. And I have a personal question, Kevin, for you. You said we are going to rely on those tapes of the Ark, so God can prove us what Ron found, and we can see the Ark through those tapes. Did you say that?
Everyone's going to see the video that's in the cave that shows Ron removing the Ten Commandments from the Ark.
I think he was referring probably to In the Earth Made New and the 144,000.
Yeah, Ron theorized that the cave would be incorporated into the new temple in the new earth or in Jerusalem, where the 144,000, their names are written into the temple, Mrs. White says. They will be able to go in there and see Jesus' blood on the Ark of the Covenant. These are the same people that were given the loud cry talking about Jesus' blood when the mark of the beast was being enforced. These are the people that stood up for Jesus, and they will be able to go into that cave for eternity and see that Jesus gave his life for us. It's beautiful how God has all this set up. And to think, you know, before Ron found this, to think that Jesus' blood would just be washed away and be an afterthought, that doesn't sound like, you know, God. This is proof of mankind has been redeemed. Jesus' blood, the redemption of man, this display will be here on earth forever where man lives. And this will be a witness of God's sacrifice, a witness of God's love. So it's incredible how all this is set up and what God has planned.
Yes, Jesus promised. Go ahead.
Even after the end of everything happens, the ark will never move. It will be a testimony for forever and the rest of the eternity.
Yes, it may stay in the cave until the New Jerusalem comes down, perhaps. We don't know, you know, how it's going to all develop, but, you know, Ron theorized it would be incorporated into the temple at some point and be a testimony, you know, of what Jesus did forever.
Sí, el arca dice que nunca se va a mover de ahí donde está y que será testimonio de lo que hizo Cristo por nosotros. Incluso después de la Nueva Jerusalén, se encontrará ahí en siempre. Posiblemente.
O sea que el arca siempre estará allí, incluso cuando haya la tierra nueva, siempre estará ahí en la cueva.
He's asking if you think the ark will be there even when the new Jerusalem is built by Jesus Christ.
Yes. Yes, forever.
Yeah, para siempre.
Para decir esto, ¿os basáis en algún texto bíblico?
In order, do you base that opinion in a Bible, in the Bible, in some text of the Bible?
No, it's just Ron's opinion of what he think God has planned.
Su opinión de Ron. Mm-hmm.
Bien, yo creo que no puedo expresar suficiente las gracias para daros por esta entrevista y me gustaría que siguiésemos aún en contacto para posibles cosas que puedan ir surgiendo sobre este tema, más preguntas que en algún momento nos podáis responder.
So, thank you very much for your time.
One more.
Really appreciate it.
Thank you. One more thing. Ron used to mention, was it Revelation 11? It speaks of the ark was seen in heaven, and there were thunder, lightning, and hail. And Ron theorized that is actually predicting the ark being shown here on earth. Notice it mentions hail. That's the time of the plagues. You know, that's not something in heaven, literally. You know, Revelation 14 speaks to the three angels' messages, and the angels are going through the midst of heaven. That's the atmosphere around here on earth, the three angels. That's us giving the message to the world and it going throughout the earth. And Ron theorized that verse, speaking of the ark in heaven to be shown, is actually here on earth, it being shown, because of the time set, mentioning hail, thunder, and lightning. And so that's a very interesting text there that Ron would bring up that backs up basically, you know, the discovery of the ark.
En Apocalipsis 11 y 14 se describe algunas cosas sobre el arca en tiempos del fin y la interpretación de Ron es que ese arca que se dice mostrar en el cielo realmente es la que estará aquí en la tierra.
Thank you for allowing us to tell some things and your interest. I appreciate it.
The only way our sins were promised to be forgiven was through the blood of Jesus. And the blood of bulls and goats cannot forgive sin. And the better sanctuary in heaven had to have a better sacrifice. And the blood of Jesus was taken to heaven to be used in the holy place and the most holy place in heaven. So our faithful high priest is now in the most holy place using his blood that was obtained from the cross to forgive our sins when we ask for forgiveness.
Entonces el perdón de nuestros pecados solo puede ser realizado a través de la sangre de Cristo y esto ya se está realizando en los cielos con su sangre de aquí.
Bien, no sé si queréis decir alguna cosa más. Veo que os estáis animando.
If you'd like to say something else, we appreciate it. It seems that you'd like to talk a little more.
Well, I've been studying about the blood of Jesus for a long time, what the Bible says and what Ellen White said. Because when I was a child, I didn't believe that Jesus' blood was applied. And I thought God was really strange to make the earthly priest kill the lambs and put the blood, sprinkle it in the temple and do everything just right. He even killed two of the priests for not doing it right. But I thought when it came God's turn, he didn't do it right. He just let his lamb hang on the cross and die and didn't bother with the blood. So I thought my sins couldn't be forgiven. And I worried about that for a few years, and then I forgot about it. When I was working at the hospital with Ron, he'd been digging for the Ark of the Covenant for about 3 or 4 years, and I thought it would never end. But he came to work one day and said, "Jesslyn, the blood of Jesus fell on the mercy seat, and that's when our sins were forgiven." And I went into shock. I couldn't move. I couldn't speak. Ron was standing this close to me, and I couldn't see him. All I could see was myself as a child wondering what was wrong with God. Why didn't he put the blood on the mercy seat?
Entonces ella explica que desde que era muy joven no entendía exactamente qué representaba toda esta sangre, supongo del Antiguo Testamento, sacrificios de animales, estas cosas difíciles de entender, y que poco a poco, y a través de los descubrimientos y hablando con Ron, ha conseguido entender la importancia de lo que iba a representar todo esto con nuestra salvación. Y que fue, Ron le dijo que en el momento en que la sangre llegó al propiciatorio, es en ese momento cuando nuestros pecados son lavados.
And that's why I'm studying about the blood now. I found lots of Ellen White quotations and Bible quotations that tells about the blood. The blood did go to heaven. Ellen White says he took his blood to heaven and presented it to God and sprinkled it on the mercy seat and on his own garments. And I'm so glad to have met Ron White and learn that my sins can be forgiven.
Incluso ahora está ella estudiando sobre el asunto de la sangre. Y puede leer en muchos textos y citas de Ellen White que habla de esto y dice que la sangre la llevó al cielo y desde allí también la está esparciendo en el propiciatorio de allí para salvar nuestros pecados, salvarnos a nosotros.
Desde luego el significado de estos textos a la luz de los descubrimientos de Ron Wyatt cogen una significación muy especial.
Everything about the blood of Jesus and the discoveries of Ron, it all makes kind of sense and give us so much information that is, I think it's a very important question these times.
Yes. Good point.
Just want to say thank you for sharing this information. We appreciate the work that you're doing too, and God will bless you.
Amen. Thank you. Nos da las gracias por compartir esta información con toda la gente que podamos y que Dios nos bendiga.
Igualmente.
God bless you too, Michelle, and all you guys.
Tened claro que por nuestra parte intentaremos llegar a cuantas más personas posibles de habla hispana que están esparcidas prácticamente por todos los países del mundo. Y bien, vosotros habláis inglés, podéis llegar a la otra parte de la población que nosotros no podemos llegar, pero creo que era necesario que esta entrevista se hiciera para precisamente poder aportar datos y eliminar dudas de lo que muchas personas en el mundo de habla hispana tenían al respecto de esto, para poder aportar estos datos al resto de la sociedad.
So we like to have all this information in order to be able to share it with all the people who speak Spanish and cannot understand English too well, and to make clear some points that are important because some people are confusing the terms and sometimes the information is not clear.
So, yes. Y Michelle, especialmente para ti y para la señora Jaslyn, os tengo envidia porque yo no conocí a Ron Wyatt.
So I was saying that you're kind of lucky to find to you were able to meet Ron and Michelle and Jaslyn, and he would like that also, but it would have been.
Quiero terminar agradeciéndoos todo lo que habéis hecho por esto y Sí, quiero deciros que en el momento en que todo esto esté editado, intentaremos compartirlo al máximo por todas partes.
So thanks again for your time, and once we have the video edited, we'll share it with many people as possible.
Thank you.
Thank you. God bless you.
God bless you. Thank you.
Digo, si os importa, terminamos haciendo una oración, y esta vez en español.
We'd like to finish with a prayer in Spanish, if you don't mind.
Okay.
Padre nuestro que estás en los cielos, te damos muchas gracias por habernos dado esta oportunidad prácticamente única, donde hemos intentado extraer todo lo posible del testimonio que Ron nos dejó en algún modo, para que esto fortalezca siempre más nuestra fe y nos ayude a poder llegar a muchas más personas con el Evangelio de salvación, con el mensaje de los tres ángeles y el mensaje del cuarto ángel que se añade de Apocalipsis 18. Ayúdanos a ser valientes y a decir el testimonio donde haga falta, para que muchas más personas se conviertan y para que los que lleguen hasta ese momento de la ley dominical sepan de estas cosas antes, porque si han esperado hasta esos mismísimos momentos finales, den también su paso en favor de ti, a pesar del terrible momento en el que eso se va a poder realizar. Te queremos pedir tu bendición sobre todos nosotros, que nos ayudes a aguantar hasta el final y a ser posible de ser miembros de esos 144.000 sellados. Ven pronto, Señor. Perdona nuestros pecados, que te lo pedimos todo en nombre de Jesús. Amén.
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 Thank you.
Gracias.
The business of touring,